Thank you, Marianne, and thank you, Board of Normal, and the High Times Magazine for giving us this incredible opportunity to get to know about one another, to discuss these different issues, and to have an awful lot of fun for one heck of a long party. Little coma. When that happened, I was told by a doctor who had an enormous heart and no fear of the consequences that are there for doctors to speak openly in America regarding my favorite medicine. Only at that time, I questioned his sanity because he told me that if I didn't start smoking marijuana, I would go blind. Well, I just didn't want to do drugs. What can I tell you? I went home and drank two more Manhattans that day, I'm sure. Well, the truth is that it was a horrifying thought. I thought it would be a dangerous stroke that would lead me to other things, and it was hard to think about it. However, as most patients find that when they need something and they find relief, whether it's legal or not, the quality of their life becomes more important than the quantity of it. We don't care if we don't live to be 120. I probably will anyway. But most of us who do cannabis will have more life. Well, come on, I've been researched by our government, and I found out this at the Iowa Convention this year on medical marijuana, that the government knew that glaucoma could be greatly alleviated by that. They just didn't know the long-term consequences. But now we know, we have plenty of evidence that some of us who were a little crazy when we started smoking, stay that way. That's all. We don't want to get crazier. And we are able to forget and understand one another and talk to each other and find solutions. I took my problems to the medical center at the Miami University of Miami, I should say, which supposed to be in the gutter if they did. But I found out that people who smoke marijuana are people who work in every segment of society, and that many of us use it medically. And that all marijuana use is medical because stress is the biggest killer. Stress. That help with these issues. So for me, it was all a brand new life. It began, I found freedom the day I got arrested. That's a little sad, I would think, but it's true. It had to be found somewhere, right? For many of us in this movement, is we gotta go to jail before we can come out free, you know? And I found that the support was overwhelming, and the people, my attorney, who also was a representative for Normal, Norman Ken, contacted Bob Randall. Bob Randall, I had heard of. Bob Randall is my hero of all times because he is the one that showed the government that glaucoma can be alleviated with the use of marijuana, and he did that back in the early 70s. So when he called me on the phone from Washington, D.C., right after I became very public, I knew the name, and I was thrilled to hear from him, and it was Norman Kent, and it was Robert Randall. That, and my doctor, Dr. Paul Pomper, the three of them, were the ones that stood with me at a trial and convinced Judge Mark E. Poland that medicine that I was taking was exactly that for me, and without it, I would definitely be condemned to a life of permanent blindness. You see, by the time I was arrested, I had about 11 surgeries to keep me from the dangers of marijuana and from the illegality of marijuana. And so I had lost my one eye completely. I couldn't tell you if there was light in a room when I went to court. So I was really ready to fight then. And I knew that if they were sending me to jail, they were telling the world that they just wanted to blind me. Unfortunately, had I been a victim of the same laws in the 90s, my judge might not have felt as free to make a rational decision because our laws just kept getting worse and worse, and they are getting worse and worse. People die every day that we keep these laws in effect. Not only in the front lines, where 7,000 people die by gunshots on both sides of the issue. All of them have parents and children and families and friends whose life will never be the same without them. This insanity has to end. But worse than that, we are killing patients, as you all know. Stories like Peter McWilliams sound unique, but are not. Peter McWilliams was a patient who got found guilty in a Mickey Mouse trial and was waiting to be put in jail while he lived by himself in a beautiful mansion in Bel Air, where next thing you know, he's dying, his son vomited. In a state where we have worked so hard to make medical marijuana a reality, not a pipe dream. It's about people like Jean Marlowe, who was born with a congenital liver disease. And this illness prevents her from taking even vitamins. So this is not a person that can be given anything pharmaceutical. And for that, I mean, because she had kind friends who tried to help her from Switzerland and sent her some marijuana to give many patients in the United States, she went to prison and she was awaiting appeal. But she didn't commit perjury in court at one of her hearings. They asked her if she had used marijuana. And being a truthful person, which most of us are because we know the law is criminal, we know we're not. She told them she did, and for that she is now serving time in a federal prison in West Virginia. And it really is up to us to get her out of there because we don't care and go on God. Who had cancer as a child and discovered the wonders of this herb and wanted to educate and help others, but today he's serving time instead. No, they're not criminals. The law is criminal, and bad laws hurt good people. Had a crazy election. I'm from Florida, but globally, I live in California now, and I say globally because you have gotten to see it. Close look at Florida politics in the last 2 weeks if you were in the United States with our elections. Maybe we begin to understand what was on down there in that banana republic. I'm sorry, I'm getting that up there. And I shouldn't feel that way because the baby was trying to smoke medical marijuana. And after my trial, I went after the government because it was supplying two men. And I became the first woman on this program today that is supplying 8 of us. What about the Todd McCormicks? And what about the Jean Marlowes? And what about that woman and that man that woke up today never to see their child again? And what about that child that didn't quite get to see what a beautiful woman looks like because he was only 13 and 14 and had, well, he could see him. Only now he's blind because he had glaucoma and somehow he couldn't take marijuana. Marijuana is the safest, most efficient, and the most reliable part of my treatment for 24 years. And that's something that all 8 of us and at least 50 others proved to the federal government in the early 90s. Through FDA, DEA, and NIDA, all the institutes on drug abuse that we have to adhere to there. In the meanwhile, their own chief administrative law judge for the DEA had told them that these rules were unreasonable, arbitrary, and capricious, and that the laws needed to change. Since then, we all know that the people took it into their own hands to talk to one another, to work for initiatives, and everywhere those initiatives have come before the voters, they have approved medical marijuana because Americans are good, caring people.
Yeah.
Our legislators are not, and we need to change them. Are gone and they can manage their lives without being a slave to the wheelchair all the time. And some of them who are in the wheelchair also find relief there that they don't find if they don't use marijuana. But what about all those millions who are today in that same need around the world that we're guilty for keeping in pain? Are we going to do something about that? I think we will. The votings have been wonderful, but it's now time for us to get on whoever ends up sitting at that White House from the very beginning and make it clear that we will not tolerate this lack of compassion, this lack of humanity, and the fact that we have a blasphemy on the Creator's work here. But it is to the Creator that we must turn at this time, whether you see it as a goddess or a god, or as I do, an infinite spirit of love that joins the soul and And that is responsible for all of us being together. This is no coincidence to me. I think we've done this work before and we will again. Because our hearts know that where there is no justice, there is no peace. And where there is no fight, there is no justice. Most of you individually or listening to what you have to say. And tomorrow we will have another panel and we will even get to sing for you. But don't tell them, they're right now. But at any rate, the one thing I would like to close with are a few of the words that I choose in one of my, this one is the song on my CD that I talked through, the only one I talked through the rest of my pretend I'm singing. But it goes like this. Most infinite spirit of love, this be the heart of all we think, say, and do, so that you may come shining through as the people we were truly meant to be. For when there is no separation, then life becomes a celebration of endless peace and joyful harmony as one in you. Through your eyes I realize every time I look at someone, everyone, even Barry McCarthy or whoever is in the White House today, all those people that I sometimes think are my enemies, I realize that these spirits too were here from the very start, created by that very loving heart, as you and I, as one in you. For when there is no separation, then life becomes a celebration of endless peace and joyful harmony. And I love all of you. Thank you. Thank you.